we call upon you, El Shaddai, for you are God Almighty, the all-sufficient one who meets all of our needs. We call you El Elyon, the Most High God, because you are above every circumstance or situation we encounter. And we come to realize that our problems are not bigger than the God that we serve. And we call upon your holy and righteous name, asking, oh God, that you will manifest your presence in this place. Oh God, that you will speak to our hearts and our minds, to encourage us, oh God, to lead from one station to the next as we continue to travel down the path that you've laid before us. For you are awesome and wonderful and magnificent. There is no God besides you, and besides you we have no Savior. And we thank you, oh God, that you poured yourself in a body and came in the personhood of Jesus Christ and walked among us that you might be touched by the feelings of our infirmities. And so, Father God, we say that we can come boldly to the throne of grace that we might find mercy and obtain grace in our time of need. And we thank you, Lord Jesus, that you are our high priest who represents us before the throne of God. And so speak to us right now. Give us a word, Father God, for we need you from the pulpit to the door to move in a supernatural way in our lives, to change us, to transform us, oh God, that we might never be the same again. So, Lord God, we ask these things in the matchless, powerful, indestructible name of Jesus Christ. We ask that you would touch my lips, put your words in my mouth, that I might preach your glorious gospel to these your people. We pray for healing all across the land, in particular into our families. We pray for emotional healing to be manifested in the physical realm. We pray, oh God, for spiritual healing to be made manifest in the natural realm. And we just give you honor, glory, and praise, oh God. And help us to be patient and wait on you, because there's nothing too hard for the Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Let those who love God say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated in his presence. Amen. That's the testimony. Amen. Amen. I want to just add a couple things to the announcement. I have been working diligently. I might have found someone, one of my minister friends. I have some people that might be able to put the roof on us for the money that we receive. So it's going to happen. Contact me. And so I'm working on that. But the beautiful thing is, I kind of told, so y'all know Reverend Mo Ladies came out and said, yeah, they were trying to get a roof. Like, man, I don't know how to copy. Why didn't you tell me? So he's getting a contact with his contacts. He's going to contact me. And so we might be able to make that a reality sometime soon. Amen. Any other things they can kind of help us with on the church. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And I'm also soliciting your prayers. I've decided to enter into another doctorate program starting in November at the Houston Graduate School of Theology. Amen. So I'm just asking y'all to pray for the pastor, because that's another challenge. And it's 3 years. It's a three-year program. And I'm praying that God will open up the floodgate to help me finance it. And because I just kind of feel that's the direction that he's leading me. Amen. I'm going to pursue a doctorate in counseling. Amen. Another doctorate. Well, not a doctorate in counseling. So pray for me on that. Amen. Now, with that being said, I want to go ahead and invite you to the book of Genesis. Amen. We're still in the book of Genesis. I want to invite you to turn to chapter 32 in the book of Genesis. And we're going to start at verse 23. Amen. When you find your place, I want to invite you to stand to your feet in reverence of God's holy word. And I'm going to be reading from the Jewish Study Bible, so my translation is going to sound a little different than yours. Amen? Amen. Let us hear the word of the Lord. The same night he arose, talking about Jacob, and taking his two wives, his two maidservants, and his 11 children, he crossed the ford of the Jabbok. After taking them across the stream, he set across all his possessions. Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until the break of dawn. When he saw that he had not prevailed against him, he wrenched Jacob's hip at its socket so that the socket of his hip was strained as he wrestled with him. Then he said, let me go, for dawn is breaking. This is the man that he's wrestling with. But he answered, Jacob said, I will not let you go unless you bless me. And some other translation says, until you bless me. Amen. And said to the other, what is your name? This is Jacob asking the man he's wrestling. He says, what is your name? And then he replied, he asked Jacob, what is his name? And he said, your name shall no longer be Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven with divine beings. Amen. Your translation will say God. Amen. And human, and have prevailed. Amen. I want to know that you catch that. He said, you have wrestled with God, amen, and you have prevailed. Amen. And Jacob answers, pray, tell me your name. But he said, why must you ask my name? And he took leave of him there. So Jacob named the place Peniel, meaning I have seen the face of God or a divine being face to face, yet my life has been preserved. The sun rose upon him as he passed Peniel, limping on his head. Amen. Look at your neighbor. Say, neighbor.
Neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
The preacher's going to preach about. Don't tap out.
Don't tap out.
Amen. You may be seated in his presence. Amen. Don't tap out. Amen. When you're wrestling with the vicissitudes of life, the unexpected life events that come, whatever your issue may be, whether it's relationally, spiritually, financially, when you're wrestling with it, don't tap out. Amen. Don't tap out. Our text is coming out of the book of Genesis, which we get this title from the Greek translation, Genesis, from the Hebrew text, Bereshit, meaning in the beginning. It is this first book of the Torah that gives us something about God that we did not know. It gives us an understanding on how everything that was created began, everything but the beginning of God. Amen. And that is significant for us to know because we talk about the community or the milieu that the Israelites emerged from. All their neighbors believed in something totally different. They believed in bowing down to trees and to rocks, and they believed in the pantheon of God. They believed that nature was a God, and the Israelites come along with this revolutionary idea and say, no, you've got it all wrong, that the true God is above his creation, not imprisoned by it. Amen. This is important for you to grasp because when you're going through issues, when you're struggling with the vicissitudes of life, you must come to the revelation of knowledge that your problem is not bigger than the God you serve. Maybe I wish I had some help. Unless you have had some hardship, unless you have shed some tears, unless you have seen some dark days and it didn't hit you. But if you have struggled with life and unforeseeable things have come upon you that you never expected, when you found out that your friends that said they had your back walked away, when you found out that you didn't have enough money and then you didn't know how you were overcome, somehow God showed up and he showed you that he was bigger than your problem. Amen. And see, when those of us understand that God is bigger than that, it makes us want to praise him. It makes us want to trust him because we realize what we did trust in didn't last. And so in this book, Genesis, we have these stories about the patriarchs. We have the primeval history of the Genesis, chapters 1 to 11, on how the world came into being. We also understand how sin came into the world. We get the beginning of this struggle between the forces of good and evil. But the most important thing we grasp is that God is above that struggle. Amen. And you have to have it in your mind, no matter what you are struggling with, no matter what you are wrestling with, it's not in the same category as God.
Yes, amen. Yes, sir.
Amen. And so as I was researching and studying, meditating on the word, I discovered that this word Torah means instruction. Yod, Resh, and Het. Now, the Hebrew verb with this particular root word means to shoot an arrow. Okay? Thus, etymologically, it helps us and refers to hitting the mark. Amen. So then you have this word sin. Now, understand what sin. Sin is a word, chata, which means missing the mark. Watch this. So when I refer to sin, what I'm talking about is when we miss the instruction, when we miss the teachings of God for us on how to overcome, then we fall into the category of sin. All right. Amen. Amen. Now this is going to be significant for you to get. Amen. From a theological perspective, Genesis is introducing us to a God who keeps covenant with his people. And this thing called sin is what corrupts our covenant that we have with our God. But in spite of ourselves, God had a plan. Amen. The Bible says that Jesus was slain before the foundation of the world. So what that tells me, you can take some pressure off yourself, because God already knew where we were going to fall short, but he had already worked out a plan so that we don't have to believe there's problem or the issue, but that we can learn how to trust in him. Amen. 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 So sin, watch this, is the proximate cause of the troubles we face in our lives and makes it hard for us to get past what, excuse me, what we sometimes never get over.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
But when we look at your neighbor, say, neighbor,
neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
Oh,
when life gets rough,
when life gets rough,
and you become overwhelmed, don't tap out.
Don't tap out.
Don't tap out. This author by the name of John F. Westfall states in his book, Getting Past What You'll Never Get Over, he says, we are human, not inflatable toys. We don't immediately bounce back and pain from the pains and the scars and the bruises that we experience in life, because these pains, these scars, these bruises are real, and he said they are often really hurt. Amen. Amen. And so what I want you to know that, see, to live and walk with Christ, you don't have to hide behind a facade like you're not hurting. You don't have to hide behind the mask as if you're not experiencing pain. But it is when you come to the realization that your pain is real and you put it in its proper place, that's when God can heal you. Y'all not gonna pray when we up in here to this morning. Watch this. He further asserts, in order to get past our brokenness, we must recognize it for what it is and set aside the need for an instant fix. End quote. In other words, he's saying there's no quick fix to some of the stuff that we're gonna deal with in life, but you have to put it in its proper place. Understanding that it's not gonna be over tomorrow, but you can learn how to place your faith in God, who will carry you through until you get to the other side. Now, I disagree with him in the book in the fact that you never get over it or get past it, because if you walk with God long enough, you begin to realize that God can heal those pains that your psychiatrist can't talk you out of. I trust you, I've had counseling for 2.5 years, and she did a great job, but what she kept doing for me is pointing me back to God, and that's what helped me heal internally and emotionally to become a better person and to get over and get past the experiences that I had to deal with in life.
Yeah, yeah.
Amen. Her point for me in the Bible, she always said, this is your scripture, every time you see the Romans 8:28, for we know that all things work together for the good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. He says, if you remember that it's all working for your good and you're not hanging up on the negative, then that's what helps you get past it and don't tap out. Amen. Amen. So when we look at our particular story here, this is a story about one of the patriarchs by the name of Jacob. Amen. And if you are familiar with the story, Jacob is a twin. His brother is Esau. And when he came out of his mother's womb, he was supposed to be first. Then he grabbed the heel of Esau, and somehow Esau still came out first. Amen. But he was trying